Interview with a Vampire by Mark Dawidziak. The passenger train had seen better days. And again, so had I. It was shabby. It was battered with use, and at this late stage in its career, with overuse. There were decades worth of dents in the metal doors and walls. The once elegant woodwork trim was chipped and scarred. What remained of the tattered window curtains were badly faded, and there were ugly gashes in the well-worn grayish seats. Through these tears, the seats coughed up white shreds of padding that had valiantly soothed bumpy rides for thousands of posteriors. Yeah, these were the telltale signs, all right. And what tale were they telling? Just that this clearly was a train rattling to the end of its long run. It wasn't pretty, not anymore. It was on the road to extinction. It undoubtedly would be retired from service without ceremony or sentiment, and I liked it. You bet I liked it. It had taken a beating, and sturdy and dependable, it was still doing the job. It didn't know that, perhaps, it was heading for the end of the line. The only thing it knew was moving forward. Night had settled over us about an hour before, and it seemed we had left the stifling heat back in Massachusetts. There wasn't much to see outside of the grimy, vibrating windows. Once in a while, the train would breeze through a small New England town or an empty station, the passing lights creating a momentary strobe-like effect inside the dim car. For the most part, though, the light inside the car had turned the train windows into inky panes of dark mirrors. Staring into this reflection, I saw a face every bit as dented and beaten up as those metal walls. A ratty pork pie straw hat was covering a retreating hairline. And beneath a jaw that has, more than once, been the target for vividly expressed opinions, there is a glimpse of a wilted seersucker jacket. Leaning close to the window and shading my face with both hands, I could catch a glimpse of a bright crescent moon in the summer sky. I also could make out a rocky shoreline that fell into the blackness of the Atlantic Ocean. Two horn blasts sent a mournful message from our train into the forever darkness. A blue-uniformed conductor opened the door in front of me, bringing with him the gleam of gold buttons and the strong smell of burning fuel. For the brief time that the door remained open, the familiar sound of clacking train wheels seemed improbably loud. It went back to a muffled lullaby rumble when the door slammed shut, closing out the fumes with a metallic click. There weren't many passengers in my car, and only one of them had not succumbed to the train's soothing lullaby rhythms. She was a smartly dressed blonde, completely absorbed in the kind of a bestseller that promises wealth, weight loss, and wisdom. I had to chuckle. She didn't look like she was hurting for money. She didn't look like she needed to lose weight. But I, long ago, learned it was not smart to question where people look for wisdom, or to jump to conclusions based on appearances. June 27th, 10:45 p.m. My name is Carl Kolchak. My journey is beginning. A journey that will link my past with my future. A journey that will bring me to a strange and dark place, to the edge of the sea, to a place called Collinsport. My past? Almost no one believes me. I was fired from a Las Vegas newspaper and run out of town by city fathers who definitely needed to work on the paternal side of their nature. Here's the part people have a rough time believing. You will too, so brace yourself, children. I discovered that a series of Sin City killings were the work of a vampire. Yes, you heard right. A genuine, blood-draining, coffin-sleeping, sun-avoiding, bite-your-neck-I-never-drink-vine vampire. And when I ended this reign of terror by driving a stake through the heart of one Janus Quazeni, my reward was a one-way ticket out of town. It should have been the story of the century, or at least the story of my career. Instead, the story was suppressed, supposedly for the good of the public I was trying to serve, and I was told to hush up, or I'd be facing a charge of murder. There were witnesses, after all, ready to testify. They had seen me drive that stake through the heart of one Janusz Korzeny. So now I was being driven out of town. If I didn't agree to the deal, I would be charged with killing kindly Mr. Skorzeny. I ended up in Seattle, hired by my former Las Vegas editor, Tony Vincenzo. Same story, different city. This time, Tony and I were both run out of town. That was our thanks for solving the case of a murderer whose bid for immortality required that he claim 6 victims every 21 years. I'm not asking for your sympathy. I'm not asking that you believe me. Hell, I have days when I don't quite believe it all. I'm just telling you how I got in this train. Tony and I headed for New York, the city of my birth. Tony quickly landed a job with the INS wire service in Chicago and Blue Town for the Windy City. He soon found a place for me at the INS Bureau, where I found nothing but trouble. Everything from mysterious deaths at a hospital construction site to a military cover-up of an android project gone wrong. It didn't take me long, about a year, to run afoul of INS owner Abe Marmelstein, who gave me the boot after my investigation of strange happenings at the Marymount Archive. How did I know that the chairman of Marymount's board was one of Abe's golfing buddies? I headed back to New York City, where I felt as welcome as a worm trying to crawl into the Big Apple. I kept plugging, but nothing came my way. Nobody was returning my phone calls. Nobody wanted to know my name. I'm not a quitter, but you can only pick yourself off the canvas so many times. After getting knocked on my ass in Vegas, Seattle, and Chicago, my fighting spirit was more than a quart low. New York was making like Janusz Korzeny, and draining away what was left of my resolve at an alarming rate. What money I had was almost gone. I had no prospects. Soon enough, I wouldn't even be able to afford the rat hole room I was renting by the week. My friend, Jeff Rice, a Las Vegas journalist, had edited my notes, articles, tapes, and research about Korzeny into book form, and he thought he had a publisher for it. I had my doubts that it would ever see the light of day. Vampires usually don't see the light of day, now do they? And even if Jeff did get it published, everyone probably would think it was a work of fiction. It was at this low point that Tony Vincenzo, sainted man that he is, got in touch to say that he was leaving Chicago. He had accepted an editor's post at the Hollywood Dispatch. Would I like to join him at that scrappy little tabloid nicknamed The Disgrace? Part of me was grateful. Frankly, part of me couldn't have cared less. And that part wanted to stay in New York. That part was the down-and-out fighter who saw no advantage in getting up. What was the point? They always won. They always would win. What was the point? I couldn't answer that question, and maybe Ma Kolchak's boy finally was seeing the obvious. I was overmatched, and I was tired. I'd done my share. It was time for... For what? Body at rest tends to get flushed down the crapper, particularly if you're in New York with no coin of the realm in your pockets. Yet the knowledge of this fundamental reality was not enough to piece the malaise that had settled over me. I was on the verge of telling Tony thanks, but no thanks, when the letter arrived. The postmark on the cream-colored envelope was Collinsport. The handwriting was, and there's no other word for it, elegant. My dear Mr. Kolchak, we have not met, but I am most anxious to make your acquaintance. My name is Barnabas Collins. The name will mean nothing to you, I'm sure, but I believe we have, or should I say, had, a mutual friend. His name was Janusz Korzeny, and I understand you met him in Las Vegas. Yes, Mr. Kolchak. I know all about what happened in Las Vegas. That has your attention. Good. I have been told that you are at present, let us say, between jobs. So would it be possible for you to visit me here in my hometown of Collinsport, Maine? There is so much to discuss concerning Mr. Skorzeny. There are things you should know. You worked so hard to get the story in Las Vegas, Mr. Kolchak. You deserve the whole story. Do come. I can assure you it will be worth the trip. If you need further convincing, please look over the newspaper clippings I've enclosed with this letter. I'm quite certain they will seem somehow familiar to you. Enclosed, you'll also find directions to Collinsport, along with 3 train tickets. The first will get you from New York to Boston. The other 2 are for connections that will take you the rest of the way. We will be expecting you to arrive on the evening of June 27th. Willie Loomis, a fellow in my employ, will meet you at the Collinsport train station. Please forgive the rather mysterious nature of this correspondence and the irregularity of my approach. All will be explained when you get here. Yours truly, Barnabas Collins. I made 5 unsuccessful attempts to throw away the letter. Each was an attempt to tell myself I didn't care enough to wonder about someone in nowhere, Maine, knew the name of Janos Skorzeny, someone who knew about me and what happened in Las Vegas. I looked at the clippings. They were small items from a couple of Maine newspapers. They were about mysterious attacks in the small fishing village of Collinsport. A baffled sheriff named George Patterson didn't know what was behind it all. In each case, though, the victim suffered an alarming loss of blood. Patterson at first thought an animal was responsible, but he was not ruling out some kind of strange cult activity. It did sound eerily familiar. Could Skorzeny have hit Collinsport before moving on to Las Vegas? Not likely. His trail had been pretty well documented by the FBI. Another vampire? What the hell? The tickets were free, and this Collins guy certainly was right about getting my attention. What the hell? The tickets were free, and this Collins guy certainly was right about getting my attention. New York and oblivion would be waiting for me when and if I got back. And if this was some kind of trap, well, nowhere Maine was just as good a place to step into oblivion as Manhattan. My reporter's curiosity wasn't dead yet, so might as well follow the trail already drenched in the blood of innocent victims. It felt like years ago that I had left Chicago, heading for New York. Would the journey end with a night-shrouded train riding into the down-east Maine town of Collinsport? This was the question crossing my mind as I sat in the train, rambling along tracks hugging the Atlantic shore. I turned the Barnabas Collins letter over and over, searching for some hint of what was awaiting me. Could I spot a clue lurking behind the handsomely formed sentences on stationery that seemed to have more in common with lace than paper? What about the clippings? From what I could tell, this Barnabas Collins was part of the family who founded the town and pretty much ran it. Digging up what I could on short notice, I discovered that the original family business was designing and building sailing vessels. Much of the current family income, it seemed, was from a fishing fleet, a cannery, investments and related ventures grouped under Collins Enterprises. How Barnabas Collins fit into the family plot, I had no idea, but I was more interested in what he knew about Janos Skorzeny. Buried deep below the murky indifference that had settled over my consciousness, there was a spark of something. There was no denying that, but there also was no denying how close that spark was from being extinguished. Any train can get off track, and if you're stuck in the middle and unable to move, what the hell good is a light at the end of the tunnel, anyway? June 28, 6:45 a.m. I awoke with a start as the train finally lurched its way into the Collinsport train station. Consciousness was struggling to win a foothold. I yawned and stretched in an attempt to reanimate stiff muscles and a foggy brain. The train creaked and screeched, giving voice to the way my aching joints felt at that moment. My bleary, blinking eyes adjusted slowly to the misty morning light streaming into the train car. We were several hours late, thanks to an accident outside of Brunswick. A truck had gone over at a crossing, spilling its contents across the track and surrounding road. Those contents, apparently, were of the hazardous kind. The train came to a halt with a tremendous jolt. The red brick station outside my window looked like the type that had been in use since the days of Commodore Vanderbilt. What I could see of the town, beyond the station, seemed to be what travel agents billed as quaint, a small town slice of New England. The design seemed to be a little bit Norman Rockwell, a little bit Thornton Wilder, and a whole lot of Nathaniel Hawthorne. A bigger, longer yawn shook loose a few cobwebs. The realization of pain in my left hand dispersed some others. My left hand just wasn't responding to the wake-up call. In fact, it was rebelling against it. Unlike the rest of me, it had the sense to stubbornly remain asleep. At some point, it had become sandwiched between my slumping carcass and the armrest, a position that left it deprived of blood. As I worked some circulation back in the numb hand, the stinging needles and pin sensation nudged my irritability level up a few notches. When the hand was somewhat brought back to life, I pushed out of my seat and coaxed some life back into leaden legs. While trying to get my bearings, I turned over a new annoyance in my mind. Is that a headache picking up speed? It would get worse as the craving for caffeine grew. My whole being screamed for coffee as I made my way to the platform. Climbing down the steep train steps, with all the grace of a skunk-drunk sumo wrestler, I blinked into the Collinsport morning until my eyes focused on a sullen-looking figure in a brown windbreaker. He was a sturdy, clean-shaven fellow somewhere in the neighborhood of 30. He was leaning against the station wall, staring at me with an expression that contained neither welcome nor scorn. I lifted my eyebrows inquisitively as if to say, "Are you the gentleman I am expecting?" He returned my gaze, but his eyes betrayed absolutely no emotion. I started to look away, but when I did, he moved away from the brick wall, pushing strands of brown hair back from his forehead. "Loomis?" I asked as he approached. "You're late," he said, as if I were responsible for the delays plaguing trains headed for Collinsport. "Not my fault," I told him, hoping he'd respond with either a smile or a sneer. Instead, the face remained impassive. This Loomis, I thought, would make a hell of a poker player. "Mr. Barnabas was expecting you hours ago," he said. "He stuck around for as long as possible, but he had urgent business in Bangor. He had to leave, but he'll be back this evening." He handed me a folded piece of paper. It was the same cream-colored stationery that had been used for the note in my pocket. I unfolded the new letter. It was the same handwriting. "My dear Mr. Kolchak, welcome to Collinsport. I've been anxiously expecting you. I must apologize for my absence from town. Your delay was not anticipated, and the business that takes me away from Collinsport cannot be postponed. I hope you will understand and accept whatever hospitality we can show you throughout the day. I am most eager to meet you and to share, let us say, experiences over a drink. Until then, Mr. Loomis will see to your needs. I trust that your journey from New York has been a happy one, and that you will enjoy your stay in our beautiful town. Sincerely, Barnabas Collins." "So you're the welcome wagon," I said, looking up at Loomis. "Mr. Barnabas told me to take you up to the house and make sure you were comfortable. Any bags?" "Nope." "This way," he said, pointing to a cluster of cars parked near the station. I followed, trying to determine if Loomis was a trifle simple in the head. The jerky rhythms of speech were undeniably odd. He sounded brusque and nervous at the same time. "Mr. Barnabas said I'm to get you anything you need until he gets back from Bangor." "Well, I need some coffee real bad," I told him as we reached a tank of a station wagon loaded with wooden beams, buckets of plaster, tools, and rags. "I'll handle it," Loomis said, opening the vehicle's front passenger door for me. We didn't have far to go. Loomis drove the station wagon a couple of blocks, parking in front of a sign that identified the clapboard building behind it as the Collinsport Inn. But it was a door to the side that caught my attention. Coffee shop. "Wait here," Loomis said, getting out and shoving his hands into the pockets of the windbreaker. "Cream, no sugar, since you asked," I said, having decided that, whatever else he was, Loomis clearly wasn't the star of the Collinsport Oratorical Society. "Right back," he said, making no acknowledgment of my sarcasm. "Take your time, Renfield," I murmured after he was out of earshot. Glancing out the front and side windows, I took in as much of Collinsport as could be seen from the front seat of a station wagon. The place stunk with atmosphere. It looked like the set for an Old Spice commercial. I already knew Collinsport was a small seaside town. The salty scent of the morning air confirmed this. Perhaps it had once been a whaling village. Maybe that's why the bar I could see perched near a wharf was called the Blue Whale. Whatever the history, it went way back from the looks of things. I started taking inventory of the buildings around me. A hardware store, an antique shop, a bakery, a law office for someone named Tony Peterson. I was looking out the back window when a rap at the window made me jump. I jumped again when I saw a wild-eyed middle-aged woman with her face pressed against the glass. Loomis seemed strange. She seemed disturbed. She hardly looked like a street person. Her clothes were not inexpensive, yet her state of agitation was extreme. Frantically, she looked around, then motioned for me to roll down the window. "This car belongs to them up there, don't it?" she asked in a wispy, urgent way. "Who?" I asked, more than ready to believe that Collinsport was a New England word for lunatic asylum. "Them," she said. "The Collins family. You're going up there." "I have an appointment with Barnabas Collins," I said as matter-of-factly as possible. The wide eyes went wider. She responded as if I had struck her. "Stay away from that place," she said. "Do you know where you are going and what you're going to? The dead walk at the edge of the sea at Widow's Hill. All the evil things in the world have full sway there. Stay away, mostly. Stay away from a place they call the Old House. You listen to what I say. For your own sake, stay away. Hey, you, get away from there." It was Loomis, moving rapidly toward the station wagon, the life-giving coffee in his right hand. She didn't wait for him to reach us. By the time I turned my face back to the right, she was disappearing around a corner, narrowly missing a young mother pushing a stroller. "Crazy," Loomis mumbled as he slipped behind the wheel. "Crazy pest." "You, know her?" I asked, taking the precious coffee from him. "Everybody does," Loomis said, his curt response laced with aggravation. "Some people think she give the town character. She's a town character, Mr. Kolchak. Nutty as they come." I nodded, the phrase "takes one to know one" sticking in my throat. I washed it back down with a sip of coffee. My brain yelled a relieved "thank you" as Loomis guided the station wagon through the small downtown, which, like me, seemed to be staggering through the waking up process. We soon left the town behind us, driving along a narrow two-lane road. We passed a homey-looking cottage here and there, Loomis settling into the role of the worst tour guide on the planet. "The Evans place," he'd say, nodding his head toward a one-level dwelling with a skylight running down the side.
"Judge Craythorne's place,"
he'd grunt, as if I knew who the hell Judge Craythorne was. "Eagle Hill Cemetery over there. The Seaview House over there." The Seaview name at least seemed to make sense. The road we were on appeared to hug the shoreline, and as we approached two imposing stone pillars, I could hear the roar of pounding surf. Luma steered the car through the pillars, past an imposing set of iron gates. Around the bend of this private drive, a well-manicured expanse of lawn swept up to a gloomy-looking Gothic mansion, complete with a tower, terrace, balconies, ivy-covered walls, and at least a dozen chimneys. It reminded me of the views of Mandalay in Alfred Hitchcock's Rebecca. "Collinwood," Luma said with as much enthusiasm as ever. "Of course it is," I said, draining the last restorative fluid from the Collinsport-Inn coffee cup. Collinwood, I later learned, was the 40-room ancestral home built in the late 1700s. The current matriarch of the clan was Elizabeth Collins Stoddard, who ran the family business with her younger brother, Roger. The mansion was so big they didn't even use the shut-up east and west wings. I was expecting Loomis to turn left, taking the paved drive toward the wooden front doors, which must have been 15 feet high. Instead, he turned right, taking a small dirt road beyond stables and what I guessed was a caretaker's cottage. There was just enough room for the station wagon on this narrow, uneven, tree-shrouded path. Bushes and branches were so thick around us, we seemed to have entered a gloomy other world where day was not allowed to penetrate. I raised a quizzical eyebrow at Loomis, who said nothing. The path opened a bit, and before us was another mansion, far different and much smaller than Collinwood. It was a white structure, with a network of pillars running around a generous perimeter of portico. It looked more like the kind of mansion you'd find on an old southern plantation than on a New England estate. But paint was peeling from the front pillars, each of which must have been 3 feet in diameter and 3 stories in height. It was hard to guess whether the house was falling into disrepair or being rehabilitated. Loomis parked beside the house, pulling beside piles of rope, lumber, bricks, saw horses, and a wheelbarrow. Putting this together with the contents of the station wagon, I quickly opted for rehabilitation, and I surmised that the chatterbox Loomis was the one doing the rehabilitating. The smell of sea air was stronger here. The sound of the crashing waves was louder. The sense of loneliness was more pervasive. I've had more than my share of blood-chilling moments, but I have to admit that things ran particularly cold when Loomis, in his usual terse way, announced, "The old house. The old house. The old house." Had I just heard him right? "The old house," I repeated, pointing toward the circular white columns, trying to sound nonchalant about it. "Yeah, that's what they call it," Loomis said, letting down the station wagon's tailgate and hefting out some sacks of cement. "So how old is the old house?" I asked him. "The original part of it goes back to the 1600s, he said. "It was a family house before they built the big house. I guess this place got too small for him. Mr. Barnabas lives here now." It was the most words he'd put together since I encountered him at the train station. He was on a roll, and I wanted to encourage that. "You live here, too?" "Yeah," he said, moving tools and supplies out of the station wagon, "ever since Mr. Barnabas came here to live." He paused with a sack over one shoulder and a bucket in the other hand. He seemed to be really looking at me for the first time. "I do whatever needs to be done around here." There seemed to be something of a threat in his voice and manner. There also seemed to be something like a hint of regret. Or was I imagining it? I decided to keep him talking, if I could. It's an old reflex for a nosy reporter. "But you haven't been living here all that long, from the looks of things." "A few years. The place was a real mess between neglect and the teenagers from town playing pranks. They'd get liquored up in the town, then dare each other to spend time in the haunted house. They don't come up here anymore." There was that suggestion of a threat again. I kept pushing. "I just assumed Mr. Collins was from around here," I said, trying to keep it as casual as possible. Loomis stopped what he was doing and fixed me with a stare. Mr. Barnabas came here from England. He was the last of the English branch of the family, and he likes it here. This is home now. Looking around as he resumed his labors, I kept thinking that there was something else about this isolated house that bothered me, as if I needed something else to bother me. I walked a little bit toward the front of the house. Then it dawned on me. It was the lack of something that was bothering me. There were no wires of any kind leading to the house. No electricity, I asked, turning back to Loomis. Mr. Barnabas don't like it. He likes the house the way it was, the way it is. No phones? I tell you, he likes the house the way it is. There was an awkward silence between us, filled only by the morning chirping of birds and the crashing waves. I gave it a healthy pause, then saw if I could make Loomis jump a bit. Widow's Hill, somewhere around here? It had the desired effect. Loomis snapped his head around, looking at me with suspicion. How do you know about that? He asked. I'll take that for a yes, I said, turning up the smartass a notch. Over there, he said with a jerk of the chin. Come on. I thought he was taking me for a close-up view of Widow's Hill, but instead Loomis was leading me up the porch steps and toward the front door. Green shutters sat on the semicircle expanse, propped next to windows about 6 feet high. Ancient boards creaked beneath their feet, and you could plainly see where some planks had been replaced. A mad thought dashed through my head. They're at the planks, I thought, recalling the delicious pleasure of reading Poe's The Telltale Heart for the first time in high school. Here, here, it is the beating of his hideous heart. Loomis didn't look much like the literary type, so I kept the thought to myself. He opened the front door, letting me into a small foyer that contained a gleaming brass clothes tree, a couple of old-fashioned candle sconces, and very little else. Straight ahead were stairs to the second floor. Overhead was a chandelier fitted entirely with long, tapered candles. It was like walking back into another century, but I wasn't sure which one. I followed Loomis. He led me down the hall, turning through an archway to the left. We were in a drawing room that could have been decorated by Alexander Hamilton's wife. Draped in red velvet and white lace, the bay windows faced the front of the house. Looking towards them, I admired what I decided was an 18th-century view. Silver and gold candlesticks were scattered around the room. A standing candelabrum, topped by an upside-down V holding seven candles, had been placed near the right side of those front windows. A crystal chandelier, also fitted with candles, was at the center of the ornately trimmed ceiling. Man's candle bill must be enormous, I remarked to Loomis, who was pulling aside the heavy front drapes to let in more sunlight. He did not respond. There were three plush wing chairs, and a comfortable-looking settee on the red and black pattern rug. On the left side of the room, near the archway, was a solid-looking piece of wooden furniture about 15 feet high, a sort of combination writing desk and book. On the right side of the room was a large fireplace with a wooden clock on the mantel. Over the mantel, in a splendid golden frame, was a large portrait of a gaunt, sullen-faced man, strands of dark hair strayed across a prominent forehead. High cheekbones gave way to hollows so pronounced it gave the fellow a haunted, almost cadaverous appearance, despite the imperious pose. His hands were folded over what seemed to be the silver handle of a cane, and his left hand bore a ring with a large black stone of some kind. I would have guessed onyx, and I would have guessed right. Although the gentleman in the portrait wore a modern suit and tie, the oil painting, somehow, didn't seem out of place in the 18th-century setting. Between the fireplace and the front window was a louver-style wooden door with overlapping horizontal slats. On the other side of the fireplace was a built-in bookcase, 5 feet wide, reaching from floor to ceiling. The house had the smell of one of those historic homes maintained by the National Park Service, a hint of mustiness, a dash of decay, the unmistakable odor of wood polish, and the suggestion of something else, something familiar but elusive. "Mr. Barnabas says you'd wait here," Loomis told me. "Make yourself comfortable."
"Oh, yeah. Right at home."
"I got chores to do," he said, walking through the doors near the fireplace, not even bothering to look back at me. What else to do except snoop around? I wandered over to the writing desk and noticed a quantity of stationery that matched the notes sent by Barnabas Collins. Well, this must be the place, I thought. I got the strong sensation of someone looking over my shoulder. I whirled around, half expecting to see that Loomis had silently returned. I realized that it was the penetrating gaze of the portrait that had given me a start. I smiled at the melancholy V-shaped face and asked, "Ever get the feeling you were being watched?" For a brief second, it looked as if the face had oh so slightly changed its expression. Was that a grim smile? No, just a trick of the light. Had to be. I strolled out into the hallway and turned left. There was a gray iron door past the staircase, something more suited to a prison than a home. It had one small window, about head high, and even that opening was filled with iron bars. I pressed my nose between two of these bars and tried to see what was beyond this curious barrier. Nothing but blackness. Yet the dank smell and cool air suggested that this was the door to the cellar. I gave the handle a yank. It didn't budge. I gave it a harder pull. I might as well have saved my strength. I wasn't getting through this door, unless I could locate an acetylene torch and a bazooka in the pockets of my seersucker jacket. Why lock the door to an old cellar? Afraid someone is going to steal the rats? Who even has a door like this installed? Are you trying to keep someone or something from getting in? Or are you trying to keep someone or something from getting out? Between this slab of iron, passing for a door, and the oil painting of Joy Boy in the drawing room, this place was starting to give me the creeps. Get a hold of yourself, Kolchak, I told myself. You've been in creepier places than this. Indeed, I had. Still, I avoided the painting's gaze when I walked back into the drawing room, and I resisted the urge to poke around upstairs. Instead, I walked over to the bookcase and killed time by examining the old house library. Lots of Shakespeare, lots of poetry, lots of history. This Collins fellow must be a load of laughs. Taking down a book of local history, I sat in one of the wing chairs and started reading up on my Collinsport lore. I don't know how long I read there before something I never thought possible occurred. I fell asleep. The repeated chimes of the mantel clock woke me from a deep slumber. I was disoriented, but feeling remarkably refreshed. It took me a few seconds to remember where I was. Running both hands across my temples, I noticed a glass of water and a covered plate on the little wooden table nearest me. There was a sandwich and an apple on the plate. Lunch had been served, undoubtedly, by Willie Loomis. It was simple enough, and I needed something on my empty stomach. About 20 minutes later, Loomis came into the drawing room, holding a cardboard box that he put down near the candelabra. Taking a wicked-looking knife out of a jacket pocket, he began to carefully scrape away the residue of candle wax. "You found lunch," he said, removing stubs of old candles and replacing them with new ones from the box. "Yeah, my compliments." "We keep just the basics in the pantry," Loomis said, continuing his candle sweep of the room. "Mr. Barnabas is a man of simple, tastes." He went through the door near the fireplace, returning with a stepladder that he set up under the drawing room chandelier. Now he went about the meticulous job of replacing those candles. "Nothing like modern conveniences," I said. I thought about immediately adding, "And this is nothing like modern conveniences," but I held that one back. From a wisecrack standpoint, this would have been gilding the lily. From a jaw-cracked standpoint, this would have been goading the willy, and Loomis looked pretty muscular under that jacket. He wasn't that tall, but I had no desire to tangle with him. "Who's the laughing boy in the painting?" I asked him. Loomis went on with his work, paying no attention to the attitude I was sending up the ladder. "That's Mr. Barnabas," he said. "It was painted by a local artist, Sam Evans, right after Mr. Barnabas arrived from England. Very striking." Loomis stopped, and still looking up at the chandelier, started to smile. He seemed to be enjoying some kind of private joke. The mood swing was unsettling. Suddenly his head whipped around, and he turned the full force of that manic smile on me. I thought he was going to giggle, but instead, in an over-earnest manner, he started talking in that half-warning, half-threatening kind of way. "That's right, it is very striking," Loomis said, the grin fixed on his face. "Why shouldn't it be? Mr. Barnabas is a very striking man, very striking, but you'll find that out for yourself soon enough. Real soon. There's another painting, you know."
"What?"
"There's another painting you should see over at Collinwood, the big house. It's of the original Barnabas Collins, the one who left for England in the late 1700s. The resemblance is, well, you'd say it was striking, Mr. Kolchak. You'd swear it was the same man, the very same man. I saw that painting before I met Mr. Barnabas, and the first time I did lay my eyes on him, what do you think? I almost dropped dead. So you really should see that painting, Mr. Kolchak. You should see it if you ever get the chance." The last part of his monologue was delivered as he descended the stepladder and folded it up. He carried it out of the room, shaking his head and laughing to himself. He returned a few seconds later, muttering now and laughing in a breathless way. "Yes, sir, if you get the chance," he said, clearing the glass and dish. He paused at the door before leaving me. He looked straight at me, the grin almost gone. "You should see it," Loomis said, then disappeared through the door. What the hell was that? I asked myself. For the first time since leaving New York, I was actually feeling a twinge of fear in the pit of my stomach. I pushed it down. If I'd ceased to care, how could I care if I was in danger? The self-delusion worked for a while, but it crumbled under the persistent chorus of voices playing like a loop in my head. "A very striking man, the dead walk at the edge of the sea, if you get the chance, most eager to meet you and to share, let us say, experiences over a drink. All the evil things in the world have full sway there. They don't come up here no more. Stay away. You'd swear it was the same man. Stay away. Mr. Barnabas is a man of simple, tastes. Stay away." My attention drifted to the painting. The same man? Instinct took over. I glanced wildly around the room. No mirrors. I ran to the hallway, up the stairs, to handsomely appointed second-floor bedrooms. No mirrors. Not one. And you'd swear it was the same man. And think, Kolchak, think, how would he know about Janos Gorzeny? Maybe they were in the same line of work. Perhaps they had compared notes at a union meeting, Nosferatu, Local 9. It was all falling into place in my brain. Sure, the mysterious attacks in Collinwood, the puzzling loss of blood in the victims, the strange way Loomis had acted since I met him, the isolated existence in this old house, probably the home of the original Barnabas Collins, the goofy dame's warning in town, the locked iron door to the basement. If my guess was right, Barnabas Collins was a good deal closer than Banger at that moment. He was taking a nap in the basement of the old house. I had been lured to Collinsport, and now wait a minute, I hadn't exactly been lured. I had gone willingly, Part of me wanted to be there, so vampire or not. There was no sense succumbing to panic. There would be plenty of time for that later. All right. The immediate question was, do I stay or do I go? Trying to resolve this dilemma in my mind, I raced back down the stairs to the front door. I pulled furiously at the polished knob. It was locked. I sprinted into the front room and threw myself at the bay windows. They too were locked. Grunting with exertion, I glanced up and jumped back in fright. Loomis had his face pushed against the glass, wildly grinning at me from outside. Adrenaline racing through me, I soon recovered and yelled angrily at the window, "Hey, hey, let me out of here! Show's over!" Loomis, still grinning, folded his arms and shook his head, "No, no, and no." I was furious and started pounding at the windows. They shook under my assault, and Loomis bolted for the front door. I met him halfway. He was like a charging bull, and I thought it best to retreat back into the drawing room. Now, Mr. Barnabas, he says you're to wait here for him," Loomis nattered at me. "And that's what you're going to do, understand? I don't want no trouble from you. You just sit quiet until he gets here. Don't try anything. I'll be right outside the whole time, so you just wait, like Mr. Barnabas says." He was giving the orders, yet he seemed to be pleading, too. What was the desperation in his voice? Was he afraid? Afraid of what? Afraid of whom? I had a pretty good idea, and fear is a contagious thing. Loomis fidgeted his way to the door, locking it behind him, and taking up his post, sentry-like, on the portico. I was a prisoner, no doubt, but I didn't have to be a condemned prisoner. I considered my insistent guard, visible through the windows. There was no getting past him, and I had no weapon to persuade him to see things my way. Well, that at least solved the whole do I stay or do I go debate. Looked like I was staying. I knew it was time to chart out a battle plan. I did have a weapon, even if they weren't the type to work on Loomis. Reaching into my right-hand jacket pocket, I slipped my hand around the crucifix I'd brought with me from New York. The other hand found the vial of holy water in the left pocket. Comforted by their presence, I moved my right hand to the inside jacket pocket. The hand mirror was still there. All I needed was a stake. I had to fashion a stake. Loomis, keeping to the portico, worked to my advantage here. Surely I could find something in this house from which to make a stake. It took me a while, but I finally stumbled on some scraps of wood in the ruins of the third floor. Sitting by a window that overlooked Loomis, I patiently went to work with the only tool I had, a pocket knife. When the point seemed sufficiently lethal, I went back to the drawing room, secreting the stake in a recess near the fireplace. Calm settled over me. I was ready. I was ready for Barnabas Collins. June 28, 6:30 p.m. The sun had not yet disappeared, but I jumped when a key turned in the front door. I braced myself against the bookcase. I thought and thought on what should be my next move. Would it be Loomis? Would it be Collins? Would it be a showdown? To my surprise, Loomis walked through the drawing room, calm as you please. He didn't look at me. He didn't take any notice of me. He went through the door by the fireplace, re-emerging a minute later, carrying a serving tray. On it were two cordial glasses and a decanter filled with a red amber kind of liquid. He set this down, went about the room, lighting candles. His manner was completely businesslike. His candle duty done, Loomis moved to the fireplace and set a match to the kindling sitting under two hefty wooden logs. With the fire working its way into a crackling blaze, he started to leave, making no effort to even nod in my direction. "Hey, Renfield," I yelled at his back, "when does the count show up?" "Soon,"
he said without turning around. Very soon. I was alone, waiting for the undead in a room alive with light. The only sound was the occasional snap from the fireplace. A smoky smell was filling the room, which under other circumstances would have been quite pleasing. I moved to the fireplace and helped myself to the poker. Who knows? I might have to take out Loomis, too. Flickering candlelight played on the crimson fluid in the decanter. How long I stood, waiting and thinking, I don't know. But I suddenly became aware of Loomis standing in the hallway, looking expectantly at the front door. Had he just returned? A summer storm was rolling in, bringing with it flashes of lightning and distant rumblings of thunder. The wind was blowing through the ancient house, making mournful sounds. There was a plaintive howl from the surrounding woods. A wolf? It couldn't have been a wolf. There was a step on the portico, followed by the creak of the boards. The door creaked open, then creaked shut, and Loomis took a step or two forward. I held my ground by the bookcase. He is here. The words were spoken in a cultured, commanding voice. The words were a statement, not a question. But Loomis nodded yes, anyway, then pointed in my general direction. You followed my directions to the letter? Another nod. Excellent, Willie. Leave us for now.
But he...
It's all right, Willie. We'll be perfectly fine. Leave us. More steps. A bat-like shadow thrown across the entrance of the drawing room, and in walked Barnabas Collins. The painting come to life, or something resembling life. He was tall, thin, and aristocratic in bearing. Although it was June, he wore the kind of Inverness cape I always associated with Sherlock Holmes. With his gaunt, angular face, he could have played Sherlock Holmes. He wore a dark brown, double-breasted suit that seemed at the same time modern and Edwardian in style. And he carried a black cane with a silver handle fashioned into the head of a wolf. Stopping under the archway entrance to the drawing room, he smiled wide enough to reveal some gleaming white teeth. Ah, Mr. Kolchak, I am Barnabas Collins, he said in a manner that was both charming and disarming. It was good of you to come. Yeah, well, your note got my attention, I said, mustering as much sarcasm and bravado as I could manage. Taking off the cape, he withdrew for a few seconds to the clothes tree near the door. He returned without the cape or the silver-headed cane, looking almost human. I am sorry not to have been here to greet you, Mr. Kolchak, he said warmly enough, his voice carrying the hint of an English accent. Yeah, I know. Business in Bangor, I said. Yes, unavoidable, I'm afraid, but... He took a step toward me. Hand extended, and I fell back against the bookcase, bracing myself. He stopped, raising a quizzical eyebrow. You just stop where you are, I said to him, my right hand reaching for the mirror in the inside pocket. I'm warning you. I know who you are. I know what you are. He smiled and took a step closer. Indeed, he said, moving closer still. And just what am I, Mr. Kolchak? This! I yelled, thrusting the mirror in his face. Ha! Like what you see? Or what you don't see, bloodsucker? The smile never left his face. Interesting, he said, not shaken even the slightest bit. That's a wise item to have brought, Mr. Kolchak. You have had experience in these matters. You have seen the undead. I'm looking at it right now, pal, I said, sounding far braver than I felt, and I have other items, so keep away. Really, Mr. Kolchak, if you would... He made a move toward me, but I cut him off, holding out the crucifix for protection. To my astonishment, he didn't turn away. He didn't even flinch. To my much greater horror, he merely smiled again. Very good, Mr. Kolchak, Collins said, putting his hand up and taking the crucifix from me. This is wise, too. What kind of super vampire was this? Didn't flinch at a mirror, wasn't repelled by the sight of a crucifix? What was I up against? One thing I knew for absolute certain, I wasn't going to fool with the holy water. I was going straight for the wooden stake. Collins put his hand on my shoulder, just as a clap of thunder shook the entire house. I recoiled, yelling out something like, "Yah!" I lunged for the stake, wildly grabbing for it, but in my panic, I missed it and stumbled against the bookcase. I grabbed at a shelf to regain my balance, and in doing so pulled down some kind of lever. The entire bookcase swung open, revealing a small, secret room containing one awful item, a wooden coffin. I turned towards Colin, sure that he would be bearing down on me. Instead, I was stunned to see him cradling the crucifix in his hands, staring at it with an expression that contained centuries of emotion. What was this? I hadn't time to ponder the strange sight. I pushed all questions from my mind, thinking, "That was your big mistake, buddy. He who hesitates is lost. You had me, now I've got you." My hand found the stake between the fireplace and the open bookcase. I whirled to face him, steeling myself for what must be done. I raised the stake, ready to strike for the heart. Just as I dashed toward him, stake poised for the death thrust, two strong hands caught my right arm and wrestled me to the ground. I had forgotten about Loomis, who had circled around and emerged from the secret room. "That's enough, mister," he hissed in my ear through clenched teeth. "What are you trying?" We wrestled a bit, but he had youth, brawn, and the element of surprise on his side. Two muscular arms soon had me in a bear hug. I was helpless as Collins advanced on me, a wry smile on his face. He moved closer and closer, with the stealth of predator. A trickle of sweat, the product of panic and exertion, made its way down my left cheek. Loomis held me perfectly still as Collins slowly, silently, made his way nearer and nearer. It seemed to last an hour, but it was little more than a few ticks of the clock on the mantel. I was sure of two things. I was about to die, and in those seconds it took Collins to reach me, I knew I wanted to live. Collins leaned over, and when we were nose to nose, the smile became ever so slightly wider. He took the crucifix and gently placed it back into my jacket pocket. "Sit down, Mr. Kolchak," he said with quiet authority. "Willie, that will do." Loomis turned me loose, and I started to rub some of the ache out of my upper arms. Then I thought better about momentarily dropping my guard. I considered making an all-out rush at Collins, but he seemed to anticipate my rash idea. "Sit down, Mr. Kolchak," he repeated, then added, "Please." He turned and walked over to the decanter with the reddish liquid. "May I offer you a sherry?" He filled the two glasses, bringing one over to me. The steak fell from my hands and landed with a hollow thud. I took the glass, and by the time Collins had reached his own, I had drained the contents in one gulp. He motioned for me to sit down, and once he had refilled my glass, he began to talk. "You are owed an explanation, Mr. Kolchak, and that's why I summoned you here," he said, pacing a bit before the fireplace. "The Collins family has many investments. One of the lesser-known ventures is part ownership of a New York City publisher. We have many connections, let us say. I can't tell you how, but I have been given an advance copy of a book about to be published under the title The Night Stalker." "It's your book, Mr. Kolchak. I believe the man who put it all together, Jeff Rice, submitted it under the title of The Kolchak Papers. Regardless, I recognize the story immediately as absolute fact." "Why? How?" Barnabas Collins sighed deeply, showing me the face of a tormented man. "I've lived a long time, Mr. Kolchak, and seen too much," he answered at last. "Yes, I knew it was fact. For one thing, I once survived as Yanis Korzeny survived, preying at night on innocent victims, bringing misery and death to everyone I loved. I was a vampire, and you are one of the few people who not only would believe such a thing, but apparently does believe it. Was? Even some curses can be overcome, Mr. Kolchak. Yes, finally, and blessedly, the curse was lifted in. Here you see before you a man free to walk in the daylight, but not free of the memories. He could see the skepticism in my face. Do not doubt your senses, Mr. Kolchak, he said. Think, I could gaze on the crucifix and look at me in your mirror. Yes, that's right, the reflection is there, and obviously I drink wine. And yes, sometimes people really have business in Bangor. Make no mistake, we're... How can I put this? We're playing on the same team, you and I, Mr. Kolchak. He smiled at me, then moved to refill his own glass. But when you were in Las Vegas, I was still under the curse, although trying to fight against it. He continued, Willie helped me. A doctor named Julia Hoffman helped me a great deal, but my, shall we say, cure was very recent. When you had tracked Janos Kozeni to his lair, I was still a vampire, hiding in my coffin in that secret room, in the locked cellar of this house, or in the Collins family mausoleums. When you stood over him, stake poised at his heart, I was still a vampire. And when you drove that stake through his heart, I knew it. I felt it. I looked at him completely bewildered. How could you know? Because, Mr. Kolchak, a king vampire can feel it when one of his lines is destroyed. He can sense it. He knows it. You see, in 1795, I attacked a woman named Marie Cosgrove, right here on the docks of Collinsport. She became a vampire and made her way to Europe. From the dates and information you give in your book, it was around 1919 that Marie Cosgrove turned Janos Kozeni into a vampire. So you see, Mr. Kolchak, I am indirectly responsible for Janos Kozeni, and I suppose for those killings in Las Vegas. It all comes back to me, doesn't it? The reporter in me was coming alive. I started peppering Collins with questions. I couldn't ask enough questions. Where? When? Why? How? But how do you know that Marie Cosgrove was the one who put the bite on Skorzeny? I asked. Poetically put, Mr. Kolchak, Collins said. I know, because Janos Skorzeny told me. Oh, yes, I met him. Once. In this very room. He had just left Vancouver, where he'd been holed up for several years, and he was about to leave for Las Vegas. He was drawn to me, he said. He sensed my presence and wanted to find the originator of the family line, so to speak. He was bad, Mr. Kolchak. Evil, even by predator standards. Well, you encountered him, you know. I believe he would have tried to kill me if he hadn't sensed that I was stronger. So I owe you more than an explanation. I owe you my gratitude. You rid the world of one very bad vampire, Mr. Kolchak, one whose acts weigh heavily on my conscience. If nobody else has thanked you, then please know that I thank you. That was it? This is what he wanted? I was giddy. We talked until 2 in the morning when, humorously enough, Colin said he needed to sleep. And after all, the night is for sleeping. He showed me to an upstairs bedroom, thanking me for making the trip and telling me that Loomis would take me back to the station the next day. I may be gone when you awake, Colin said, adding when he saw my doubtful look, more business in Bangor. Well, people really do have business in Bangor, I said. Say, one last question. Whatever happened to Marie Cosgrove? Collins looked troubled. At the point the curse left me, he said, I had never felt her presence torn from this sphere. I would have to assume she is still active. June 29, 11:15 p.m. As luck would have it, the train taking me out of Collinsport was the same one that took me in. It was on the return run, as was I. I felt somewhat renewed after my visit with Barnabas Collins. The man I thought had lured me to the old house to kill me had just wanted to thank me. The being that once drained life from victims had given life back to me. I was heading back to New York. Then I was heading for Los Angeles, Tony Vincenzo, and the dispatch. When the conductor came through, I decided to ask how much longer the old train would be in service. Ah, hell, he said, punching my ticket. They've been talking about retiring this bucket for years. I can't count the number of times I've heard she was through. One day it will be true, maybe. But I wouldn't be surprised if she were still chugging away 20 years from now. This has been Interview with a Vampire by Mark Dawidziak.